Morning, this is Bruce from Community Television. I'm down here at the Women's March, and I've got Ellie and Janae with me, and they're going to tell you what the march is all about.
Thanks, Bruce. The march is about, it's a women's march, and they're happening all over the United States today. This is the Eau Claire chapter. We are marching for not only women's rights, but also the civil rights of and basic human rights of immigrants, minorities, LGBTQ. There's about 100 people here so far here to support that cause, and it's really inspiring.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have anything to add?
I mean, it's just really special. We're just here to try to help advocate for people because we need to advocate for ourselves and advocate for each other now, I think. So.
Again, I want to thank everyone. I know we already listed, but if anyone wasn't listed, this did come together very quickly, and it wouldn't have come together at all without so many people helping us with that. And I want to thank everybody that's here today. What's more, when we were starting to put this together, we were thinking, oh, well, we'll be lucky if we get like 50 people. And just look around right now. You guys are amazing. I'm not holding myself together well, but we will! I just want to say thank you for everyone being here to show our community that we'll keep fighting. We will keep fighting for a country that cares about all of its citizens, even when it feels like our government might not.
Today, we will use the Women's March primarily to express our support for women's rights and human rights in our community and the country rather than to criticize politicians or political parties and to hold the people accountable to respecting these agreements. All right, so those are the rules. That's the boring part. As Serena said, we have quite a few amazing people here to speak. So why don't I introduce our first person? We have a wonderful lady, community member, and citizen. Please welcome Amanda.
Thank you all for being here today, and thank you to Christina and Serena and Ellie for this opportunity to speak. My name is Amanda, and I work in the anti-sexual violence movement. I'm also part of a community-based LGBTQ health equity coalition called Safe Spaces of the Chippewa Valley. And I see some other supporters out there. That's great. We started in 2015. So when I say community-based, what I mean is we're all coming from different professional fields and personal experiences, but we are all motivated by the shared mission of improving the safety, visibility, health, and well-being of LGBTQ plus people in the Chippewa Valley. So, the past year has been filled with a real sense of cascading traumatic stress around a lot of the issues that we address, like violence and health disparities, and the inability of people to access fundamental needs. But there's also been an equally strong sense of urgency. And to start making sense of this and to find direction, I thought a lot about the experiences that I have had in the 90s working in AIDS activist spaces. So I was a student, a high school student at the time, and witnessing the height of the AIDS crisis was just incredibly formative for me, and it opened my eyes to the importance of coalition work. So what I learned, one of many things, is that here in the Midwest, outside of urban centers, those who were not directly affected by the AIDS crisis could choose whether or not they wanted to be aware of what was going on, both globally and locally. And many of us have that same choice today, too. We can remain oblivious, and that's the more comfortable option. But as painful as it is to pull back the curtain and commit to awareness and vigilance, it is the right choice. When we realize how all these just big, horrific forces like racism and sexism, homophobia, transphobia, and ableism are all connected, we can grow in our compassion and solidarity and the drive to keep pushing forward. I also want to mention another takeaway lesson. So just over 20 years ago, in 1996, I was in Washington, D.C. at another march, and it was held in conjunction with the final display of the AIDS Memorial quilt in its entirety. It was just incredible, especially because 1996 was also the year when actually successful HIV treatment regimens started, basically bringing people back from the brink. So in contrast, just a year earlier in 1995, we'd seen the most U.S. AIDS deaths to date. So how did this enormous change happen in the span of just 12 months? Well, it didn't. This was the result of decades of relentless pushing from activists of all stripes. So from people with AIDS who cultivated scientific knowledge to inform and steer and advise epidemiologists, to volunteer care networks, to people organizing protests and direct actions, and writers and artists who recognize the transformative properties of art and storytelling. Last November, just after the elections, David Franz published the book How to Survive a Plague, which is an exhaustive history of the U.S. AIDS activism in the 80s and 90s. And David Franz is someone who was on the ground during those plague years, and he faced unimaginable loss, both personally and on a community level. So when he was out promoting this book this winter, he was asked very frequently about how to apply the lessons from what those years of struggle taught him to what is happening today. And his response was this, that vigilant resistance is vital, and though the fight will be long and difficult, those with no power can absolutely bring about change. So I think we can take those words with us today and into the future and remind ourselves of the possibilities that exist in community and in coalition. And also remember, in the words that I borrowed from a poster from the May 1993 for the group AIDS Action Now by the artist Scott Shalevin, to look after each other. So thank you all. Reverend Julie Lett from the Unitarian Universalist Congregation.
When I was 5 years old, I wore my father's clerical collar to my elementary school. And people said, you know what, you're a girl. You can't be a minister. Well, you know what? I'm a minister and I'm a girl. And I'm here to tell you that people of faith across Christian and Muslim and all faiths believe in one thing, and that is love. And that's why we are here together, not because we stand at a particular point in history, but at the entire specific, important point in history where we have to raise our voices, no matter what our beliefs, and say that people have worth. People have value. For our Muslim brothers and sisters, our gay and lesbian and trans and bisexual brothers and sisters. And I hope you will give the prayer of your body to this march. I hope you will give the hope of your heart in the following days and not give in to fear, because fear, my friends, is the mind killer. If you've read the books from Dune, if you know that fear is the thing that will make us quake and sit on our couch. But I see hope here, and I hope you find faith in these signs, and I hope you find faith in all of these beautiful, worthy faces. I want you to say it. I stand for love.
I stand for love.
Amen.
Yay! All right, let's bring up our next speaker here. We have Don Garcia, a healthcare advocate. Good morning, everyone. My name is Dawn Garcia, and I'm a
what's really right. The system has faced increasing insurance costs for employers, gaps in coverage for millions of patients, and serious financial shortfalls for hospitals, with two-thirds of the hospitals in the U.S. in the red or very close to the red before the ACA. The system was simply unsustainable. What I saw as a healthcare provider was patients waiting until they could move or breathe before they come to the hospital because they couldn't afford it or they didn't have insurance. Parents would hope and pray that their child didn't have a car accident on the way to or from school because they knew that they couldn't afford the cost of insurance and their basic cost of living. Patients with high blood sugar or high blood pressure who couldn't afford their insurance couldn't make those payments and then unfortunately couldn't get coverage afterwards because then they were pre-existing condition bound. Over 70% of patients' families with a significant healthcare event end up with a bankruptcy or a financial crisis. The ACA, nicknamed Obamacare, was passed in 2010, providing equal access and affordable coverage to all Americans. It was designed to address all of these issues. It wasn't perfect, yet it was a big step forward. What it did was provide affordable and sound essential health benefits for all, especially free preventative health care services. Provided coverage for those with pre-existing conditions, covered children under age 26 on their parents' plan, extended Medicaid in states that allow that, and provided health care coverage for 20 million Americans. It resulted in the lowest uninsured rate in our recent history and reduced the rising cost curve that impacts healthcare premiums. Repealing the ACA when it has demonstrated such strong results in all areas of benefit is callous and irresponsible, impacting about 30 million people. These are our neighbors, friends, and family, maybe even you. I heard from the Eau Claire County yesterday that there are 4,000 people in Eau Claire County at risk as this is repealed, if it occurs. These are your friends, your neighbors, those around you. Many more will also be impacted by the system impacts. As we know, Eau Claire is a large industry of healthcare. In addition to the human lives impact, there's a financial impact. Repealing the ACA will result in premium spikes, massive Medicaid and hospital shortfalls, while the middle class sees tax hikes and wealthy see tax cuts. The Congressional Budget Office, not fake news, reported that the first year of the repeal, insurance rates are projected to rise between 20 and 25%, with 18 million uninsured. Within 10 years, 32 million will be uninsured, and premiums will double. Preventative care, vaccines and health screenings, is much less expensive than dealing with serious illnesses. Yet preventative care without insurance coverage doesn't happen. Illness care happens, based upon cost and access. We need to do better. Civilized societies can and should do better. America needs to demand better. These are real consequences to real people. It matters now. Repealing the ACA without an effective replacement that covers all those in need is heartless and irresponsible. A replacement plan has not been forthcoming across the aisle in 6 years. Now we are anticipating chaos in the healthcare system impacting all of our citizens. The first day in office, the new administration signed an executive order to freeze the regulatory requirements of the ACA as the first step to repeal. We need to act now. We need to contact our senators, representatives, and the new administration to state our concerns and facts about the repeal and to ask for their support. We need to send an economic and a human message on behalf of all Americans. I'm asking you to do two things today. To be informed and tell others about the real story about the ACA, and to contact your representatives. If you don't know the number is 202-225-3121. Tell them that you do not support the repeal of the ACA, and if they proceed anyway, you will remember them at the polls. Our message is heal, don't repeal. Heal, don't repeal. Heal, don't repeal. Thank you. All right, our next speakers, we have two coming up to the stage here.
community advocate Hao Pei. And let's also bring up Jennifer Jung. Come on up to the stage. They have a couple things to say.
Hi, my name is Jennifer Jung. I'm young, but I know life can be hard. I want the best for the world. I want people to be happy. I'm marching today because I think women are important. And sometimes women get treated differently and people don't always notice. Women have more responsibilities. You have to put yourself out there more to say something, and you have to achieve more and fight harder. I see this in the women in my life. My hero is my Auntie Pa. I admire how she helps people even though things are stressful. She helps everyone to be happy. I want people to be as happy as other people and not stressed about so many things. This is why I think courage is something that helps you move on in life. Life is not perfect. For instance, my mom is from Laos and she was not able to go to school because she had to work to support my family. She has trouble with English and people say things. She wants me to be able to go to school. I want to graduate college and get a master's or doctorate and become a doctor. To help people. When things get tough, I take a break and listen to my daughter's face thinking. I would want my daughter to be positive, but she will see that the world isn't perfect. If I could change one thing about the world, I would change racism. Because I was not a certain color, my friends were like, I am white and you are, and they didn't know what to call me. I know we are all supposed to accept each other, but it seems like it is hard sometimes. I had a friend who was bullied because of her race. She was also bullied because girls are said to be weaker. I know life is hard and stressful, but women survive because they have courage.
Marriage is driven by poverty and
and many more. Both women and their families are victims of aid in these practices. And might I add that this is just the surface of what most women face. However, with women, I've learned that even though we have different experiences, we feel pain in the same way, and our emotions flow from the same place. I work as the very first sexual assault advocate in the Eau Claire area. Some of my experiences include victims, fear of reporting, and the confusion of misunderstanding the system. I have witnessed victims that are weighed down with shame and guilt, even from loved ones. Assault victims can be forced to marry the perpetrators to save theirs and their family's reputation, and that the act is minimized by victim blaming and shaming. Sexual assault is, to say the very least, a sensitive topic and especially taboo to discuss in the whole community. With majority of community leaders being male, it creates a barrier to report issues or even begin dialogue about such sensitive topics. I speak today not to defame or bring judgment to my people, because in all cultures, my culture is beautiful and rich in many ways. I am working to bring awareness, to shed light onto a culture that I love and cling so tightly onto. I am working to open doors so that rather than judge each other for our differences, we as women support and stand by each other. And I am marching today, well aware that many of my sisters of color are not marching. I will follow my sister Volta Orabe with her quote, "I will use this political moment to keep at it and to act on faith that we can do better to make our social justice movement truly inclusive and intersectional." The Women's March recognizes that women deserve to live full and healthy lives, free from all forms of violence against our bodies. We believe it is a moral imperative to dismantle the gender and racial inequalities within the justice system in our community. As Michelle Obama said, no country can ever truly flourish if it stifles the potential of its women and deprives itself the contributions of half its citizens. We stand together recognizing that defending the most marginalized among us is defending all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer and Hal. All right, we're going to be getting to our last speaker this morning, and then we will get marching. I feel I should go back over for people that have just got here. We are marching on two sides of the street, led by myself, Ellie over here with the gray hat. Careful, it's slippery. No weapons, no alcohol. Keep it civil. And a tone of respect, honesty. No violence towards physical or verbal towards any person. Okay, that's it. All right. Let's bring up, I'm very, very happy to have our last speaker here today. Please welcome Councilwoman Catherine Emanuel. Capitol to see Barack Obama sworn in as our 44th president. Our family, like
like so many other people, worked so hard on that campaign, including my then 3-year-old daughter, who hit doors with her mom, who said, "We're doing this, and we're door knocking for Barack and Obama and Joe the Vitamin." She cringes when we remind her of that, so don't tell her, okay? Little secret. So let's go back to the inauguration. Being there felt like we got to stand in a monumental page of a history book. Because it was, we were standing right in the center of history. After the ceremony was over, there was a collective sigh, like, ah, the Bush days are over, Barack got sworn in, all is good. So there were so many people there that it would take hours to get back to our hotel. So we decided to just walk around, and we found our way to a church who had planned for welcoming people like us, welcoming strangers who needed a place to go. They opened their doors, they served hot meals, had hot drinks, and a warm place for us to sit and connect with people all over the country. Meeting strangers who now became our friends. This love and hospitality touched me deeply. Fast forward 8 years, and my, January 20th, 2017. Not how I pictured it to be, as I had so hoped for another person who was smart and seasoned to be sworn in. Earlier this year, I had the opportunity to meet Secretary Clinton. I was pregnant then, just by a few weeks, and in my few seconds I had with her, I shared how overjoyed I was that when my new child would be born, she would be the new president. I saw the grandma twinkle in her eye, and she congratulated me. I cherished those few moments. It was yesterday's inauguration that I had believed and so hoped that it would be our turn to have a smart, fierce, and experienced leader who just happens to be a woman, take her seat in the Oval Office. I must admit that it stings that the opposition was sworn in, with almost 3 million votes left and evidence of international state-sponsored trolling and tampering with our democracy and our election. And there's more. I'm still shaking my head at this whole situation we're in. What are we going to do when we have people on the national level, like an oil tycoon who was awarded a friendship award from Vladimir Putin, who is now being vetted for Secretary of State, and a nominee for Secretary of Education who is seriously justifying the need for guns at school in case a grizzly bear just happens to stop by? I mean, really. These are the realities that we have to deal with. We're not whining, we are incensed. What are we going to do about this? We still know, and we have to know, that our future is up to us. I see the future is female. I'm with you. Each of us has gifts and passions that we choose to use, helping in big and little ways to make right when things seem so wrong. Many people before me have talked about tapping into our talents, like Dr. Martin Luther King, who spoke to a group of high school students in his sweet speaker speech. In that speech, he said, "And when you discover what you will be in life, set out to do it as if God Almighty called you at this particular moment in history to do it. Don't just set out to do a good job. Set out to do a good job that the living or dead or the unborn couldn't do it any better. If it falls your lot to be a street sweeper, then sweep the streets like Michelangelo painted pictures, and sweep the streets like Beethoven composed music, and sweep the streets like Shakespeare wrote poetry. Sweep the streets so well that all the hosts in heaven and earth will pause to say, here lived a great sweeper who swept her job well. If you can't be a pine at the top of the hill, well then be a shrub in the valley and be the best little shrub on the side of the hill. But if you can't be a shrub, be a bush, if you can't even be a tree. And if you can't be a highway, then just be a trail. And if you can't be a sun, then be a star. For it isn't the size that you win or fail. Be the best of whoever you are. Now more than ever, we need to see the best in one another. If you are an organizer, organize. If you are a writer, then write. If you want to influence the laws and how things are run, run for public office. And if you're like the minister at the church in D.C. who 8 years ago let a bunch of strangers in for a hot meal and fellowships with strangers, then keep opening the doors and your arms to bring people together. The work before us is plentiful. Our sisters and brothers marching today all call for working toward ending violence and fighting for reproductive rights, rights for all sexual orientations, workers' rights, civil rights, disability rights, immigrant rights, and environmental justice. We have our work cut out for us, and we have a lot of opposition that is downright terrifying. As I shared earlier, I have many moments that I shake my head at this new political landscape. However, when I think deeper about how am I going to move forward, I have to make an active choice to choose love over fear. What the opposition has laid out is something to be fearful of. However, I cannot, and we cannot, become immobilized by anger and hatred. We must believe that somewhere and somehow, love is greater than fear. Now, I'm not talking about soft and fluffy love. I'm talking about a love so deep and a compassion to stand up with peace and respect to build the beloved community for all. Spread love, not hate. That's how we will make America great. Thank you.